Most people love their dogs and take care of their dogs. If you imagine betraying that trust that you've had with that animal and forcing it to fight another animal, to me that is probably about as low as you can get with an animal abuse.
This is not something they do naturally. This is something they've been trained to do by humans. They can be seriously injured or killed in these sorts of confrontations.
This is top-end professional dog fighting, which is happening all around the world, very much like a boxing match.
And also, there is the betting side of it.
I've heard amounts of 50,000 euros being bet on. In America, potentially more. Training regime that the dog is put through, it'll be put on treadmills. It may well be injected with illegal drugs.
The worst bit of the evidence that we had was a video Nikolov sent us where a dog literally collapses from the injuries it suffers. That dog died the next day.
I've learned Nikolov had been linked to dog fighting in the UK.
The key thing was to get Ivan Nikolov reveal what he was doing, buying and selling the animals to take part in the fights. The question then was, how do we engineer it so that we do the deal without spending £3,000 worth or BBC licence fee payers' money on buying a fighting dog? I'm Tom Symonds. I'm a Home Affairs correspondent with BBC News, and I cover mainly crime and justice. Always wanted to be a journalist. I joined the BBC in 1993, and I've been there ever since. I took a call, I think it was in 2016, from an old friend of mine. He'd just started a new job as head of the League Against Cruel Sports, and they'd started looking at dogfighting. And he said, you know, this is something you should be looking at because the kind of people involved in dogfighting are involved in other sorts of crime. I'm an outsider. When you're in that situation as a journalist, is you need somebody to help you, somebody who does know what they're talking about, who's lived and breathed it.
I'm Mark Randell, and I'm a former senior UK detective. I've been investigating animal abuse around the world, including dogfighting.
I can remember the day I first met Mark. I was introduced to him at the League Against Cruel Sports headquarters. They were putting fairly experienced journalists together with a fairly experienced police officer.
It was September 2017 that I sat down with Tom. We discussed where we could take this investigation. Dogfighting is rarely prosecuted in the United Kingdom and even more rarely prosecuted around the world. We felt that it was really important to shine a light on everything there was to do with dogfighting at a very high profile level. This is official, albeit illegal, dogfighting at a professional level, which is happening all around the world. This is totally different from two lads who go into a multi-story car park with dogs they think that are tough.
We needed to know how the culture worked, who was involved, before we got to the point of trying to work out who we would target and how we would target them.
My goal with Tom on this investigation was to showcase everything there was to do with dogfighting, from when the dog is bred, the keep, how the dog is trained, the fights, where does it do the fights, who's involved in the fights, what happens to the dogs that are involved in the fights, and then the breeding process again.
Mark's evidence pointed to one guy in particular who was at the centre of a lot of this web that was stretching across the world. His name was Ivan Nikolov. One thing we didn't know was the extent to which Nikolov was involved in other crime.
When I was a police officer looking at a gun running operation between the north and south of England, I was aware that they were gun running during the week and weekend they were dogfighting.
The kind of people who are involved in this sort of dogfighting are involved in drugs, they're involved in organised crime.
One cop that I'm aware of was talking about that they recover more drugs from dogfighting warrants than they do from drug warrants.
This whole game is now very much online.
There is the obvious social media sites, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. There are forums, there are closed groups, there's the dark web, there's the deep web.
Dogfighters put their dogs on databases, which are actually freely accessible.
If you have a look at why dogfighters fight, most of that is about ego and self-importance. And therefore, if you want to show off that you're important, you're going to leave clues because you want other people to see you're important.
Ivan Nikolov, we know, was travelling to and from the US and other parts of the world transporting dogs. Some of the early evidence was a picture he'd put on the internet as part of his dog transport service, and there's a picture of a cage. The bars had been bitten apart by some animal and there was blood on the bars. Now that's not a normal family pet that's being transported. And we managed to work out that one of Nikolov's dogs had probably come to the UK and had probably bred a dog in Wales.
He's tried to fight dogs in Greece and Russia and other Eastern European countries.
We realised that we had to get some first-hand evidence.
We actually need to film a subject, and therefore we need a different operative.
Somebody who could engage with this man and win his trust. And we found that person, and her name was Sylvia.
I am an Italian investigator. I work undercover to expose the dogfighting.
Because we had the social media contacts with Ivalo Nikolov,
I contacted him asking if there was dogs available for my uncle who was interested in dogfighting.
The conversation Sylvia was having with Nikolov really did work. He started to engage with us.
Slowly, we asked him about his activity and his dogs and how good the dog was in the dog fighting.
And he started sending messages, which was crucial because we then had a video of a dog fight, which is horrifically graphic. These two dogs are going at each other. There's blood everywhere. It's not a fatal fight. The dog survived, but it's quite clear how much of a nasty business this is. Sylvia had got us into the position where he was prepared to meet us, to take us to buy a dog from a contact of his. And so we had to work out how to get our team and him and Sylvia in the same place and how to do it safely.
That's quite a high risk situation where the operative is meeting the individual for the first time.
We was nervous, but we was confident because we planned everything.
He's offered us a fully grown fighting dog. The price is 3,000 euros, and we're on our way to meet up with him. We went to the place that we'd arranged to meet him. We were set up in various parts of this restaurant. We had somebody in the restaurant undercover. Our two undercover investigators were there. I was outside in the car park. We had a security advisor. I think we had about 600 euros and some paper to make it look like we had more. All ready to go. No sign of the guy we were hoping was going to arrive.
We was very nervous because waiting so many time, it's not easy. You think that all the time that you invest on that job, maybe it's close to be lose.
It turned out he'd been stopped by the police. They stopped him for speeding, and then 4 hours later, he suddenly turned up.
So I have medical gear and documents, also blood test and export certificates.
Job was focused on Tom and the crew,
hello,
asking him why he's doing that.
The most important thing is to have your first question on your lips, ready to go, because if you mess that up, it can be something you can't recover from.
We'd like to talk to you about your dog's business. The dogs you're trading around the world, how much money do you make from that? How much money are you making from it?
Nothing.
Nothing?
No.
You're not making anything? You're not trading fighting dogs around the world?
No.
Yes, you are.
We've been watching you for some time, Ivo.
No.
Is it right that the dogs that you put into fights get injured and get killed?
No.
So why do you do it? You can answer our questions.
I don't know you. I don't want to talk to you.
And that was it. The job was done. Sighs of relief all round, and hopefully a compelling bit of journalism.
Sinclair.
When we did this story, the highest penalty for animal cruelty of this sort was 6 months.
It took until 2021 for England and Wales to recognise that animal cruelty should be given appropriate five-year sentencing.
The story ran in February 2019 on BBC News at 6, BBC News at 10, radio, online, across the board, which is the result you want. Only one thing I think that perhaps made me a little bit sad, we weren't able to discover a dog, rescue a dog, take it out of harm's way. It was always going to be impossible, and it was impossible. And that's always a sad thing to think back on.
I've got a passion for animals. I love animals, and therefore when I see people who are willing to use dogs to fight each other, it hurts to watch that. And it hurts the dog, it hurts the community, and it hurts me as an investigator when I'm looking at it. But I feel as an investigator and someone who has a passion for animals that it's my responsibility to look after those dogs because nobody else is.
But it's about revealing what's going on, and that has its own power. There's a real value in opening the audience's eyes to what's going on.